call. My name is Cynthia Dill. I am the state representative.
Which one's yours?
121. And also have the honor of serving as a councilor for Cape Elizabeth. Tonight's public forum on tax reform is an opportunity for a distinguished panel of experts to discuss tax reform, and also an opportunity for members of the public to ask questions, and for members who are watching on TV to call in their questions. Tax burden and the need for tax reform is something we hear about and talk about a lot, yet we can't seem to get it done. There have been numerous failed referendum initiatives, such as Pulaski and Tabor, and in December 2007, the legislature was on the brink of passing a comprehensive tax reform package that would have reduced the tax burden on Maine citizens by $140 million, while at the same time stabilizing revenue from the state's tax base. The House of Representatives passed it by a comfortable margin. Unfortunately, in the 11th hour, it failed by one vote in the Senate. Tonight, we are honored to have with us a distinguished panel of guests to explore this issue. I am pleased to introduce to my right Representative John Piotti, who is a Democratic state representative from Unity. John is serving his third term in the House of Representatives and is the House Chair of the Legislature's Taxation Committee. He also serves on the Agriculture, Conservation, and Forestry Committee. Professionally, Representative Piotti is the Executive Director of Maine's only statewide land trust focused exclusively on preserving Maine farmland. Mr. Piotti holds 3 degrees from MIT in engineering, public policy, and management. Welcome, Representative Piotti, and thank you very much for being here. To my left is Senator Carl Turner, who is a Republican state senator from Cumberland County. Senator Turner is serving his 4th term in the Maine Senate and is the ranking Senate Republican on the legislature's Appropriations Committee. He has previously served on the Labor Committee, Education Committee, and Health and Human Services Committee, and he brings an extensive professional background in information technology and banking to the legislature. Senator Turner is active in his community and is a member of the Board of Advisors for the Margaret Chase Smith Policy Center, the Board of the Gulf of Maine Research Institute, Hospice of Southern Maine, Maine Audubon Society, and Health Info Net. Thank you very much for coming, Senator Turner, and welcome to Cape Elizabeth.
You.
To my far left is Senator Peter Mills, who is a Republican state senator from Somerset County. Senator Mills is serving his 2nd consecutive term in the Senate, though his legislative tenure includes service in both chambers since 1994. Senator Mills is the ranking Senate Republican on the legislature's Educational and Cultural Affairs Committee and has previously served on the Insurance and Financial Services Committee, the Taxation Committee, the Labor Committee, the Judiciary Committee, and the Appropriations Committee. Senator Mills owns and practices law at Wright & Mills Law Firm in Skowhegan and is a founding member of the Somerset Economic Development Corporation. Senator Mills is an outspoken advocate for sensible change in tax policies and school fund systems.
I've been reading my website.
To my right, someone we all recognize, I think, here in Cape Elizabeth, is our very own Ann Swift Kayata, who is serving as the president of the Maine Municipal Association, a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization that works to promote and strengthen local government on behalf of its voluntary membership of all but one of Maine's 493 cities, towns, plantations, and organized townships. Ms. Swift Kayata has also served as a Cape Elizabeth Town Councilor since 1999, during which time she has served as Council Chair, Chair of the Finance Committee, and Chair of the Appointments Committee. Her professional background includes work with Mobil Oil Corporation, Johnson & Johnson, and Unum Life Insurance Company. Anne has received her MBA from Harvard Business School and has a BA from Mount Holyoke. Anne, you look right at home.
I am, except I'm in a different seat.
Yeah, that's right. To my far right is Dana Connors. Dana is the president of the Maine State Chamber of Commerce, which advocates on behalf of 5,000 companies for a thriving, low-cost business environment in Maine. The chamber focuses its advocacy efforts on tax reform, health care, workers' compensation, economic development, education, and government spending. Prior to assuming his current position in 1994, Mr. Connors served for 10 years as Commissioner of the Maine Department of Transportation under Democratic Governor Joseph Brennan and Republican Governor John McKernan. Previous to his work as a commissioner, he was the city manager for Presque Isle for 16 years. He has served on numerous federal, state, and regional boards and commissions. Thank you and welcome, Mr.
Thank
Connors.
Thank you.
Appreciate you making the effort. And finally, but certainly not the least of our guests, is Martha Freeman, who is currently the director of the Maine State Planning Office, which provides independent analysis to the governor and legislature on the development of the state's economy and conservation of its natural resources. Prior to assuming this position, Ms. Freeman served as the director of the Maine Legislature's Office of Policy and Legal Analysis and as a special assistant to the Attorney General. She has also been a public policy and management consultant, a counselor in private practice, and an environmental author. Ms. Freeman earned a law degree from the University of Maine School of Law and a master's degree from the University of Maine Graduate Program in Clinical Counseling. And I thank you, Martha, very much for joining us this evening. Also here to assist me is Representative Larry Bliss. He's in the TV room taking questions from callers. Representative Bliss is the Democratic state representative from South Portland. He is currently serving his fourth term in the House of Representatives and is the House Chair of the Legislature's Utilities and Energy Committee. His career is in educational administration. Representative Bliss is running for the District 7 seat in the Maine State Senate for the next legislature. And I'd like to welcome you all in the audience and those of you who are watching us on television. What we're going to do this evening is first hear from Representative Piatti a summary of the tax reform package that was passed in the House of the Maine Legislature last year, but like I said, ultimately failed in the Senate. Following Representative Piatti's summary, I am going to pose a question to each of the panelists who will be given an opportunity to respond, and then the other panelists can follow up if they'd like. Following my questions, there's going to be an opportunity for members of the audience to ask questions, at which time you'll be asked to please come up to the podium so that the television camera can focus in and properly announce your questions to the audience at home. And finally, we'll be hearing some closing remarks from the Speaker of the House, Glenn Cummings, who is expected to be here in about 20 minutes. So with that, I will now turn it over to Representative Piatti, who is going to, in hopefully 10 minutes or so, be able to, 15, I know I keep cutting down his time. In 15 minutes, we'll describe for those of you in the audience and for those of you at home listening, the tax reform package that is the subject of tonight's forum. Thank you. And go ahead.
Thanks, Cynthia. Thanks for pulling this panel together. There's people at this table who I'd love to get in one place one time and ask some questions of myself. So you've done a tremendous job pulling folks together. I want to start out with some basics. And I guess the real basic question is what is tax reform? And the simple answer is it's some change in the tax code, presumably designed to help someone. Now, to certain people, I think the only kind of tax reform is tax relief or tax repeal of some sort, removing a tax. But I think it's generally acknowledged by folks who work in this field, certainly by economists, most efforts at tax reform are really revenue neutral. They're a matter of moving things around, emphasizing one part of the tax code over another. A classic example of this is at the municipal level, whenever you do a revaluation. That is tax reform. Ronald Reagan's 1986 reform of the federal income tax system was a tax reform. Revenue neutral, winners and losers, moving things around. Now, if that's what it is, why do it? Why bother? I mean, if you're interested in gaining more revenues, it doesn't help you. And if you're sort of on the other side and your primary interest is in seeing government shrink, it doesn't do anything there either. So why bother? Well, that's a great question to which there fortunately are a lot of good answers. One, tax reform done right can provide a fairer tax system. Tax reform done right can provide a simpler tax system. Tax reform can make sure that revenues are more stable. which is a critical issue and one of the many problems that our current system faces. Our tax code currently, about a third of the revenue of sales tax comes from only two items, car sales and building supplies. Both items that when the economy starts to go down, those sales begin to plummet. So we're incredibly vulnerable, and that volatility in the tax system is a huge problem. Another reason to undertake tax reform is to promote some behaviors that you might want to see happen, notably good economic development. There are some taxes that have greater weight on the economy than others. Most economists will tell you, if you want to see income growth, don't tax income as much as perhaps taxing consumption. So there's all these issues. And then finally, if done right, tax reform, even if it's revenue neutral, can provide some element of tax relief. And I need to explain this. Because as I said before, tax reform, if it's revenue neutral, it's more of a shift. But there will be some winners and there will be some losers. And those winners and losers can be characterized in different ways, but a common goal of reforming a state tax system is to shift more of that burden to non-residents. Exportability, it's usually referred to. And that, if done well, can lower the burden, even in a revenue-neutral system, for Maine residents. Now, some people bristle at this because they say, wait a second, what you're doing is putting the burden on tourists, we rely on tourists, et cetera, et cetera. The idea is not to stick it to folks from away. The idea, potentially, it has to be carefully balanced, is to make sure that folks are paying their fair weight. And if you look at our current system, there are visitors to Maine who get a lot of tax breaks here that they don't get back in their home state. So that's why you bother. Let's talk about, however, the difficulties. A lot of people have worked on this for many years. For at least 20 years that I know of, folks in Maine have tried to make something happen at the state level without success. Now, this past year, we moved the ball further down the field than it's been in many, many years. As Cynthia mentioned, we had an extensive process within the Tax Committee. It resulted in a bill. It wasn't perfect, but it was pretty good. We had 11 out of 13 members of the committee supporting it, one Republican, one Democrat who didn't support it, often an indication that you're in the right place. It passed the House, did not pass the Senate. I won't go into the details of what happened and why. I think some of that might come up. But I do want to give you a little summary of what was in that package, not because it was perfect, not because that's what we necessarily want to replicate, but because it's illustrative of how tax reform works. That package really had three components. First, we were trying to lower the income tax rate significantly. Second, we were trying to provide some property tax relief. And third, we were going to pay for it somehow in broadening the base of some taxes, broadening the base of the sales tax, adding some other taxes, increasing some like the meals and lodging, goosing that up from 7 to 8%, things of that sort. On the income tax side, our goal was to bring, we currently have a marginal system, marginal rate system, it's progressive in a way, but you start paying at the top rate by the time you're making $28,000. So it's not as progressive as some people might think. And you hit that top rate of 8.5% pretty quick. We were proposing a flat rate. I know that scares people. We're not all believers in Steve Forbes here, but I'll explain in a moment how we have it presented. We were talking about a flat rate of 6% initially in the original plan, and then maintain that progressivity through a very clever credit that would be provided back to residents only, a way of making sure that the benefit of the system, because there are many non-residents that pay income tax as well, another effort at exportability and making sure the benefit sticks to the people we want it to. That's the income tax portion. On property tax, we were talking about doing some enhancements to the current circuit breaker. But that was a modest part of the proposal. And some of you may ask, why so much focus on income tax? Because if you ask the average Mainer, a lot of them will say property tax is their biggest concern. Well, the committee worked long and hard on this, and our response is the following. First, it's a tax within the state of Maine's complete control. Property tax, even though there have been efforts with, and I think the jury is out on whether or not they've been successful for the state to try to control some property tax efforts, it's not completely within the state's control. Second, we hadn't focused on it for ages. And perhaps the third reason is the income tax is a huge disincentive to business investment and business expansion in the state. We thought that by focusing on the income tax, it could be a kickstart to the economy. On the expansion side, we were talking about broadening the sales tax pretty extensively to a number of services, primarily consumer services. We had excluded pretty much all business-to-business services. But consumer services, initially we were talking about haircuts, things of that sort. We backed away on some of that. But other things like amusements, be it going to the movies or whatever, repair services, things of that sort. And there's a reason to do this. It wasn't just to gain the money to provide the relief on the other side. There's some good economic reasons to do this. This is a big part of creating that more stable tax base in the future. And it's, quite honestly, a big part of fairness as well. Maine taxes 24 out of 160 items that are taxed nationally. Connecticut, for instance, taxes 81 of those. So this is an instance where, again, people come to Maine and get tax breaks here that they don't get at home. This stuff really isn't rocket science. Most states have, in the last 10 to 15 years, as their economies have changed, as it's gone more towards a service-based economy, have begun taxing services. And it makes sense for a variety of reasons. So that was the elements of the package. The impacts of it would have been, first off, as Cynthia mentioned, a burden reduction because of that exportability of somewhere between $70 and $140 million. It depends on how you look at the numbers, and different economists have legitimate different ways of looking at it. But it would have had some true burden reduction for Maine residents. Our income tax rate would have gone from the 7th highest in the nation to the 16th lowest, which we think would have been a huge flashing neon sign to spread the word that Maine is open for business in a new way. We would have had far greater stability, and if you look at the budget crisis that we are in right now, it's not all due to the fact that we have plummeting tax revenues from certain items, but if we had had a broader sales tax base, some of that problem would have been removed. Maybe it was only $20, $30 million, but it would have been awfully nice right now if the folks in the Appropriations Committee didn't have to find that extra $20 or $30 million. Beyond that, because most people think that incomes, most economists, I should say, think that income is going to grow greater than sales tax revenue, and because we think a system like this will be a spur to the economy, we'll have greater revenue growth, which might scare some people, but if done right, greater revenue growth is the only thing I know that ultimately is going to get our tax burden down lower. As it comes in, the state can use that to reduce burden further. That was then. What about now? I think the conventional wisdom is we're terribly challenged in the state right now. We've got a huge budget crisis. It's an election year. How in the world can you think about something like this at this time? You have a lot of people who worked hard and earnestly on this package last year, who stuck their neck out and voted for something that was characterized by folks as being a tax increase. They're going to be very hesitant about doing the same thing now. So you can easily take a step back and say, there's no chance, there's no way, why even bother? But I think there are others, including pretty much everyone on this table, I think, from what I know about them and what they've been working towards, who also believe that now is an opportunity. If we don't take a step now, some of these budget crises that we have now are going to be that much greater a year or 2 years from now if we don't expand that base. If we don't take steps now, we're going to be missing opportunities for economic growth that we need. And to the extent that a revenue-neutral tax package can provide some burden relief to Maine people, that's money in Mainers' pockets that they wouldn't otherwise have. That's the definition of an economic stimulus package, exactly what we need right now. Having said all that, it's not as easy as it sounds. And as we get into questions tonight, I think you'll hear all the reasons why this is tough stuff. But I ask you to keep your minds open, and maybe with a little luck and a little broader community support, we can make it happen.
Thank you, John. Excellent job on the timing as well. Appreciate that. Well, Mr. Connors. what Representative Piatti just described sounds like a good idea. And my research indicates, however, that the Maine State Chamber of Commerce has opposed every tax, every major tax reform effort over the last 12 years. Is that, my question to you is...
What's the coincidence of my being there and opposing all the taxes?
Is the Maine business community basically comfortable with the state's current tax status quo, or why did the chamber oppose last year's tax reform package?
There's a lot of questions in that particular statement. Are we concerned about our tax situation? Absolutely. Let me go back to what John has presented to you and answer your question as it relates to last year and where we are today. I think that John would be the first to tell you that he is fully aware of the state chamber business interest and looking at the tax reform issue. But there, as he said at the outset in his presentation, as we saw last year and continue to see, is very good, is very complete. And I think the one thing that we have always said from day one is that few times that we have worked on this issue or anything close to it have we seen the completeness, the openness, the willingness to work with parties concerned. I mean, that kudos to John in particular and to the whole committee. What you found, a lot of agreement, both in terms of what was intended to be accomplished as well as the process they employed. The state chamber, the business community, looks at the tax burden as a major impediment in reality, but also in perception. Reality from the point of view that it becomes a business issue. Perception because every time you pick up a report, you read we're number one, and that's not confined, that publicity, to the state of Maine. It goes everywhere, and it becomes a distraction for business attraction or growth. So we're totally with the committee and their efforts to deal with a reform question, in particular with an eye towards lowering the income tax. Absolutely. And we work very closely with John and the committee in this respect. We also realize, as a revenue neutral, there's going to be some give and some take. It goes without saying. You've got to have that. Our biggest concern from day one, which is a separate issue, but it's a companion issue, and that is lowering the tax burden. For the last several years, for who knows how long, that we've all been trying to get our arms around the burden question. And LOD1 was a reflection of that first step towards trying to control the rate of growth in spending. That's a pretty significant point. There's efforts today to talk about spending cuts, and they're doing that as a state to address revenue shortfalls. And we stood up the other day to say the answer to that is not a tax increase, it's to deal with the problem at hand and try to wrestle that issue to the ground by cutting spending. But we're also saying that looking forward, the way to really significantly reduce the tax burden is to deal with spending. When we appeared at the very first open session, which they held at the very beginning, they asked us what our issues, our opinions were, and we say we want tax reform to go forward. An accompanying piece is lowering the burden. We need to control our rate of spending. And what was missing from LD1 was not the spending limits, but it was the threshold when you went to override those spending limits. We worked that out with MEA, we worked that out with Maine Municipal Association, and said this is an essential first step. That spending override that goes with the spending limits will give the people the security that when we move the tax blend around, as John expressed, we will not run the risk of raising taxes to be used in the budgetary process. It was not their intentions to do that, but one legislature does not bind another. So those spending limits and the controls that went with them were critical. That was our beginning statement, and that was our barrier towards the end of it as well. That takes nothing away from their work. We appreciate their continuing to pursue it because there is something to be said for momentum. John has said to me more than once, you know what, it was discouraging at the time, but the truth is we're stronger and closer today because of our experience of last year, and I believe him.
Thank you very much. Would any of the panelists like to follow up on Mr. Connor's response at this time? Anyone? Okay, turning now to my friend, Senator Turner. The Maine House of Representatives has always been more supportive of comprehensive tax reform than the state Senate. The 2002 tax reform plan was supported in the House but flatly rejected in the Senate. The so-called Saxel tax reform plan was developed and advanced by the Speaker of the House. The 2007 tax reform plan was also killed in the Senate. Why is the Maine Senate so hostile to tax reform?
I don't know that it is hostile to tax reform, but I think the consistency you would see from the dates that you mentioned probably have a common thread, which is lack of focus on spending controls, limitations in the growth in spending, and perhaps an abiding fear that tax reform would be a stealth candidate for tax increases. So I'd use that as a starting point. I think also reflecting on 2007, your recollection is that it failed by a single vote. I can't count more than two votes in the Senate besides Senator Mills and myself for the offering. And I think of the work that John Piotti and the tax committee did on this offering for 2007. They literally spent months heads down. And I think personally came up with an excellent, excellent package. But it was not well understood. It was not well understood by many of the people inside the legislature, and it was even less well understood by those outside the legislature. And so I don't know that we can spend a lot of time reflecting on what didn't work, but let's try to focus on how can we put forward a package that can get supported in this very difficult environment. I'm fond of quoting the sage of Eagle Lake, Senator John Martin, and he was present when Maine's Constitution was voted in 1820. And he's told me...
He wrote it. rewrote.
I think he rewrote it. He's told me many times that, in his judgment, comprehensive tax reform is impossible. So far, he's been correct. But I think we have yet another opportunity, more modest, perhaps, than what we saw in 2007. But I still think the principles... what you want tax reform to have, John and the tax committee have adhered to those. And while this doesn't go as deep into income tax reductions as I personally like, it's very much a step in the right direction. So with that, if I haven't passed my 3-minute mark, I'll stop anyway.
Thank you, Senator Turner. Would anyone like to follow up on what Senator Turner said? Senator Mills, I'd like just briefly to hear what...
Well,
do you have any other
it needs to be said, Carl and I were two senators who did support John's
Thank
work,
you.
And quite vigorously. It was an extraordinary achievement, frankly, and it sets a new base lodge level, I suppose, for further work on tax reform. Anybody who wants to start working on tax reform, I just brought it up on my laptop to remind myself of what's in it, but anybody who wants to start again on tax reform has to use that document. From last year as the base, because it's superb work, and it took them months and months to put together. It failed in large measure because I think a lot of the members of the business community who would, there were shifts of tax burden onto sales tax burdens onto elements of the business community who weren't previously taxed for services and the like, and there was a significant shift of a tax onto real estate transfers with a particular focus on taxing higher price transfers so that you would be hitting the out-of-state people more heavily than some of us who live in more modest housing. So it was an appropriate thing, but the real estate brokers looked upon it as a tax on themselves almost. It wasn't. It was a tax on their transactions, but not on their income. In any case, it was resisted stridently. By the real estate community, and it was resisted by other, I think by beer and wine people and by some other people who were going to be hit with having to collect on the state's behalf additional income, sales taxes rather. And in the end, most of our Republican friends in the Senate followed the dictates of the business community and said, well, this is not for us, we're not going to do it. It was viewed, I think, too much as an enabling, possibly, an enabling of further spending. If you make taxes too easy, even if it's revenue neutral, you don't want to enable them to do any spending. And so that was the general attitude. And without strong Republican support, the Democrats in the Senate were not willing to support it. And so in the end, I don't think it failed by one vote. I think it failed by many. I think in principle you're correct. There may have been a one-vote differential, but that was within the caucuses. I think when you got to the floor, it failed more substantially.
Yeah.
But so the public vote, the real vote may have been by one vote. The public vote was more substantially because, in all fairness to the parties, the Republicans did not feel that they could. Most of them felt that they couldn't support it, and the Democrats didn't want to be viewed as supporting it alone. And so it failed for that reason. And I think the Republican posture, to be fair about it, was that they wanted to, if there had been some greater level of budget control,
yes,
or cutting combined with the reform, there was something there you could take home and say, well, I'm sorry that you, sir, are being taxed more, but look, we've got to cut in spending, greater control over spending, and your income taxes went down even though you're paying more in sales taxes. I mean, there were ways of selling it, but we weren't in a posture, really, through the tax committee's efforts, certainly, to do anything on the spending front independently of the revenue.
Thank you, Senator Mills.
I could just mention one thing. On the spending constraint, there was a companion constitutional amendment, as I recall, that failed. And some of our colleagues in the Republican Senate caucus were hanging their hats on that.
That's right.
And I think, as Peter Mills points out, it was going to give them cover, if you would, to support this openly. And when it failed, and I think that failed in the House, the implied agreement between the members of the Taxation Committee started to unravel at that point.
I think both those opinions are extremely apt to what did happen. Here's an added footnote, I guess I would say, is that John and committee's efforts continue, and some of the things you've just heard have been modified. It's more conservative, if you will, I guess is an apt term. But I think the challenge still confronts us, which are twofold. One is the spending limit that gave us heartburn for the very reasons that have been repeated here is also followed up by the fact, and two or three of us have pointed to it or have alluded to it, is that there will be businesses who will be taxed that weren't before. And in the economy that we're in, that's tough. And what we have a hard time doing is looking at Paul Harvey's The Rest of the Story, because the income tax does come down. And if you're a small company that files as an S corporation, we need to find a way to be able to provide the analysis and or the opportunity for people to look thoroughly at what are the pluses here as well as the minus. And when you look at the expansion to those companies that pick up an added burden, that's even more important for them, because without it, they're opposed to it, and we can all understand that.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. That's a good point. I'm going to ask John a quick follow-up question, and then I have a question for Martha. John, you've heard it now from a number of panelists that one of the barriers to a successful passage of your tax reform package was the unwillingness or the inability of the Democrats or the supporters of the initiative to commit to spending caps. And I'd like you to comment on that and give...
Absolutely. Well, first off, we have a spending cap in place. It was part of LD1, and it's not been exceeded. I don't think many people in the public realize that we have one, and we're way below it. We have been since it was put in place. Nonetheless, I hear exactly what folks are saying, and we've tried to be responsive to that. In the iteration this year that we've been shopping around and testing the waters with the business community, we're looking at alternatives to what was proposed last time. I think everyone realizes that the barrier of a of a constitutional amendment to restrict future tax increases isn't going anywhere, for probably political reasons, maybe for good policy reasons as well. And I have to hand it to the business community, the Maine State Chamber, the Portland Chamber. We've been having conversations for 6 and 8 months, and I think we all came together in the summer, we licked our wounds and got a little rest, and said, okay, rather than just arguing this doesn't work, oh, but it has to, let's take a step back and see if there's a different approach. And the different approach we came up with, which I'm not sure is working, but it's more hopeful, is involves three elements. And maybe you don't want to hear about it now.
Well, I do have, following my questions, I'm going to ask each of you to comment on the prospects of successfully achieving tax reform in this session or somewhere in the near future. And so So it sounds like, but what I heard you say is that you at least are willing to commit to additional spending limitations in order to compromise and meet the business community in some of their...
The idea of some element of reasonable spending restraints. If that's a way to sell a tax reform package, I mean, you're a member of the House Democratic Caucus, we've presented those ideas. There are some people who bristle at it,
yes.
But there's a lot of people who say, this is the price of admission, I'm willing to go there.
Thank you. In Representative Piatti's comments, he mentioned the fact that we are currently in Maine facing $195 million or so shortfall in our budget, and it's due in large part to a decrease in revenue, or we didn't collect the revenue that we had anticipated. And much of that revenue was sales tax, and the argument that Representative Piatti has presented is that had we accomplished tax reform and broadened our sales tax base and had a more stable revenue stream, that we might not be in such dire straits right now. And my question is, do you agree with that? And if so, in your capacity as sort of representing the governor in some of the tax negotiations, if you could explain why the governor wasn't supportive of last year's tax reform package.
In 3 minutes?
Yeah,
do the best I can. Well, first I do, like, I think everybody who was involved have to commend John and his leadership, along with Senator Joe Perry of Bangor, of the Taxation Committee, and what they did to produce the tax reform package that they did produce. And I think everybody in the legislature, in the business community, I think too, in the governor's office, really thought it was a remarkable piece of work. And then, how do you get things done? And everything is related to everything else in life and also in the legislature and in the realm of policy. I do agree that obviously expanding the tax base would reduce the volatility of government revenues. We obviously get on a bit of a roller coaster when we have a downturn, especially more and more as Maine's economy is affected by the national economy. We didn't used to be so much, but we are now very much affected by that. And so we're having a big downturn in the national economy, and that is impacting Maine and therefore impacting revenues of all kinds, sales tax in particular, because we are, as John said, we only tax 60 items or so. We depend a lot on the big ticket items like appliances and home construction materials and all that. Obviously, in tough times, folks aren't remodeling their homes or making big purchases as much. So that is true. If we had a more expanded base, we would be probably bringing in some more revenue. Now, I think we'd still be in a downturn, but we'd be bringing in some more revenue. However, the problem with that, if you're selling tax reform as revenue and tax burden neutral, is that if we had done your tax reform package, John, and we had this terrible national and Maine experiencing the impact of that economic almost recession, and yet we would be bringing in more money in terms of government revenue than we would have under our old system, not your new system, that actually would have increased, we would be, have been increasing Maine's tax burden. And so we'd have more revenues coming in compared to the incomes we have. Our incomes aren't going up very much these days. So we really would have increased our tax burden, and that is another goal that Maine has, along with trying to find ways to help stabilize our revenues. We're also trying to lower our tax burden. We are have one of the highest state and local tax burdens in the nation. We are high in tax burden in New England, obviously. We have higher energy costs than other New England states. Those are problems for economic development in Maine. So you can lower our tax burden either by raising Mainers' incomes, because taxes are a ratio of what's your income and how much of that income are you paying in taxes. We could raise our incomes, keep our taxes the same, and we would be lowering our tax burden. Or we can, with the existing incomes we have, try to lower the taxes that we're taking out of people's pockets. And right now, a lot of folks in Maine are having their gas tanks and their furnaces and their mortgages and all those things take more money out of their pockets these days. So I think the governor has spent his entire administration having to deal with budget deficits, basically. He hasn't had the opportunity to try to spend more on new programs. He is a Democrat. He does care very much and believe very much in government. He cares very much about the middle class in Maine. And I think his sense of tax reform is that the time hadn't come yet, that we needed to do more public education so that people would understand really what the impacts would be. Because as Dana said, for some folks, it would be a tax increase. It would be businesses collecting tax, sales taxes, who never had before. We would export 30% of our meals and lodging tax, but 70% of an increased meals and lodging tax would be paid by folks going out to McDonald's or any high-end restaurant, but everybody would be paying more in that. And that we needed to just educate people more so they would understand that even though it might impact them somewhat negatively, it would feel in their day-to-day life it was a greater good for everything. And the governor also felt that tax reform had to be tied to government efficiency, program prioritization, so that we could reduce government spending in Maine.
Thank you. You're welcome. Okay. Well, hopefully this tax reform will be a little bit of that education that we need to do in order to achieve tax reform. And I'd like John to respond briefly to...
Sure. A couple of things. First, I don't envy Martha or anyone in the administration, because it really has been an incredible period of time, the last 6 years, one crisis after another, economic downturns, spending restraints, the like. And I think, given all of that, you folks have done a remarkable job, and you're still smiling, which is really a testament to you. I do want to comment on a couple of things that you said, though. First, this idea of revenue neutrality. It's a tough issue because you can only really look at it at one point in time. I mean, if you're designing a system that hopefully is going to bring in more revenue and then use that increased revenue to lower tax burden, you actually want a system like that. But as Martha said, she's absolutely right, you can lower tax burden by having incomes go up. There's also the flip side, which is if nobody is spending money on things that have taxes associated with them, and thus your revenues go down, you are decreasing people's tax burden. So people's tax burden have gone down in the last year. But I would argue that's not the kind of decrease in tax burden you want. That's happening because people don't have any choice. So I think we have to be careful. And economists can twist and turn these things in many different ways, and I think we need to be careful. A couple of other points that Martha raised. I'll get to that one later. I think I'll leave it.
Okay. Does anyone else want to comment on Martha's response? Okay, turning now to municipalities. MMA was a proponent of the tax reform package, even though it primarily had to do with income tax and sales tax, and municipalities typically deal with and are concerned with and raise property tax. And my question to you, Anne, is what interest do municipalities have in the broad-based kind of tax reform that was proposed last year by Representative Piatti in the Tax Committee?
Well, we have a great deal of interest. We in local government, I think it would be fair to say, are the closest to our constituents. We all have mutual constituents, but we are the ones that in municipal government are the ones that run into them at the gas station and at the IGA and the dry cleaners and everywhere else on a regular basis. And we do hear about property taxes. It's all interconnected, as we all know. The state budget has a tremendous impact upon what happens to us on the local level because state mandates roll down onto us, and many of them are unfunded. So those are expenses we have to deal with. And then we depend on the state for revenues, state revenue sharing on the municipal side of the house, and then on the school side, aid for education. I want to step back, though, and commend, like everyone else, Representative Piatti for all the work he and his committee did. It was a Herculean effort. It didn't quite pass in the end, but it was, I think, a good foundation for what needs to be done. The Maine Municipal Association, which is the association that represents the interests of all municipalities in Maine, except one, but we represent their interests too, even if they aren't members. We've been working on tax reform issues for years and years and years, and I won't go through the whole history of it, but last year we formed a coalition between the Maine Municipal Association, the Maine Education Association, the Maine State Chamber, the Maine Service Center Coalition, the Maine Better Transportation Association, and the Maine Hospital Association. This is a disparate set of people and groups representing all sorts of not entirely congruent interests, but a lot of overlapping interests. And we put forth a bill, LD 804, which was sort of the coalition's proposal. And I speak here as it's sort of interesting. Everyone else here works in Augusta, I mean, or at least for state government in one form or another, except for Dana and me. And you know, I'm down in the trenches on the local level, so I am not so much of an expert on the ins and outs of why it passed and why it didn't pass and you know, all that kind of stuff. But MMA, the coalition bill, was based on three principles which I think we would still support, and that is that Maine governments should adhere to annual fiscal benchmarks. And that's adhere, not just have, you know, nicey-nicey little targets, but adhere. And we know that's tough medicine, but we do it on the local level, at least in Cape Elizabeth we do. And I know it hurts sometimes, but government is about making difficult choices and balancing all important competing needs. So that's the first principle. The second principle is we think that Maine governments should adopt enforceable plans to achieve long-term fiscal goals. And also, thirdly, we should invest more wisely, more aggressively, and more responsibly in the long term. And that's where we overlap with the chamber. It's where we overlap with everybody who works for state government. But, you know, as for saying what our interests are, those are our interests. And those are the important questions that we hope all you folks who work in Augusta can achieve this year.
Well, that's quite a task that you've given us.
Well, and, I have a lot of faith.
Thank you, Anne. Would anyone like to comment on what Anne said about municipalities?
I think there's a problem at the local level in Maine, and I think it's probably one of the governors frequently mentioned it, and I think it's probably one of Maine's biggest challenges. We have, in our schools, we have the second lowest pupil-teacher ratio in the United States. We're about 11.3 students per teacher. We have the 10th highest education costs per student in the United States, give or take, but around number 10. Our teachers are not paid well, by and large, but the cost of education in Maine is extraordinary. We are a distinct outlier. And it is not the role of the state, at least in our system, to manage those costs. We are a revenue raiser for K through 12 education. We are a fiscal agent to raise money and distribute it in some way to try to even out the burdens. But there are grotesque inefficiencies, not only within the education infrastructure and system, but I would also suggest at the local town government level. I think the last time there was a consolidation of two municipalities is when Dover and Foxcroft got together and they couldn't decide on the name. And so, I mean, we've reached a point where it would make a lot of sense to consolidate services, both municipal services and educational services in schools. And there is extraordinary resistance to doing that. But all of the global figures show us that Maine is an outlier in its failure to achieve meaningful efficiencies in the delivery of services at the local level. And it's sad because the state itself it has been asked through the MMA referendum back in June of 2004 to come up with new money to provide funding for schools. And we struggled to do that over a period of time, the last 3 years or so, and we've run out. And this year, GPA is going to be flat-funded. We're going to fall flat on our noses. We're not going to make 55%. We can't do it without putting a penny on the sales tax, frankly, and there's no mood to do that. So we're out of money. The subsidies to support our inefficient education system are running out, and the State Planning Office has looked at the money we did spend during the past 3 years and found that most of it did not go for property tax relief, but did go to increasing spending beyond the rate of inflation in our schools. So this is a tough thing because you're fighting the religion of local control. We feel that we are, and some of us actually are believers in it. I like local control. I'm fond of it, but I don't know that we can afford it.
I want to make a comment also.
While Peter's
piling on, I'll jump on the pile. I'll be Sam Ha. The whistle blows, and I'll jump on the pile. We have a current conundrum regarding the consolidation of school administration, which our governor put forward and got passed in some form last spring, roundly resisted by local providers of education and many municipalities. And yet, as Peter Mills points out earlier, all the facts and figures show you time and time again the structure is inefficient and we have more administration than we can abide. Not only do we have too many teachers in the system, we don't have enough children in the system, and we have way too many administrators. Yet there's a reasonable chance this whole thing will come unglued with local pressure being applied to legislators. And I would say this publicly, since I've said it privately, never underestimate the ability of the legislature to do the right thing, because many times they won't, and this is an example where I think they are not acting in the best interest of the state and efficient delivery of governmental services. We can all pick out points of praise or condemning language for any sitting governor. But one of the things that John Baldacci has repeatedly tried to do is to promote more efficient delivery of government services. He's tried it voluntarily. He's tried it less voluntarily. And it gets roundly resisted. Now, my origins are in eastern Maine and Washington County specifically. And it's not an exaggeration to say that upwards of 90% of the education costs in Washington County have been paid for by people from Cumberland County. So we've been asked to send money to Augusta for redistribution to other parts of the state. And local control to me is send money, shut up, and leave me alone. And I think it's long overdue that we move forward from the 17th century to the 21st century, and significantly restructure our delivery of local services.
Thank you, Senator Turner, for those remarks. And Ann, you wanted to follow up?
Sure. Well, I would never say shut up and send me more money. I'm more likely to say please send me more money.
Be quiet.
That's because you're not from Eastern Maine.
Perhaps. I will not argue with Senator Mills that there are not gross inefficiencies in some places in the state, especially in K through 12 education. And I know that as far as the LD1 targets go, the majority of municipalities have met those targets. This is excluding education. The municipal governments have met those targets over the last couple of years. The 82% of the school systems have not. And I am very well aware, because I'm known as a fiscal, probably conservative in this town, and I have this conversation every year with the school department when it comes time for budgets, I'm very well aware of the class size issues and the myriad of other issues that have to do with education. But I would say, as far as local control goes, that I think there's been too much focus on consolidation for consolidation's sake. I wish there had been more focus on saving money and increasing efficiency, because from my point of view, speaking only for myself, the way the consolidation laws have sort of rolled out and are in the process of rolling out is that the focus has been on just merging and assuming that there will be savings. And I know from personal experience in Cape Elizabeth, we're not consolidating with anybody because we're a low-cost, a highly efficient school system. And we have done that by consolidating within our school system and our town governments together. We share a lot of services. So I think the local control aspect is you can save money doing things in other ways. So I would not buy into the fact that your supposition that local control necessarily means inefficiency. And I will say that the coalition bill did support regionalization of school systems. Mm-hmm. So that was part of our, we recognized that that was a great issue that needed to be addressed in this state.
Thank you. Ann, did you have anything to follow up? Okay, I have one more question for Senator Mills, and then I'm going to follow up asking all of you to give your take on whether or not tax reform can happen, and if so, how. I'd ask you to limit your comments to 1 or 2 minutes, and then we're going to take questions from the audience. Senator Mills, the 2007 tax reform proposal was developed on the principle that there should be more tax emphasis on consumption, i.e. the sales tax, and less tax emphasis on labor or income. Although that shift represents a tax policy more generally espoused by conservatives, it was roundly criticized by conservatives in the business community last year when the tax reform effort was defeated. And my question is, why are many conservatives so strongly criticizing what essentially is a conservative shift in tax policy?
Well, I think I addressed it briefly earlier. I think I can't speak for them because I didn't hang with them on this issue. And I hesitate to, but I have a somewhat deeper understanding than many people with that mentality, having to deal with it frequently. I think that there was a sense at root, and this was not articulated, all right, but I'll give you what I think was at a gut level. And that is, as long as spending is out of control in our poor state, why do we enable them? And if you make taxes a little bit easier, even if you don't raise them and you don't lower them, even if it's a revenue-neutral proposal, it will make taxation in general a little more palatable to Maine people, and we don't want to do that because spending is out of control, and we got to get at the spending, and let's keep it difficult to raise the money. And that was never articulated, but I had the sense that was something of the emotion that was at the root of the hostility. And then you seize on causes, reasons to oppose, and it's easy. You find somebody who's going to be paying a new tax on sales, and that person is opposed, and then as I said, there were the various interest groups, business groups that came forward, and many of them said, why are you picking on me? Why don't you go out and reduce spending and reduce everybody's taxes? You know, and at that point, people would tune out and the debate was over.
Is that possible? Just to reduce?
Well, no, we've got, right now, we are reducing spending dramatically.
Yeah.
not under the pressure of limits, because we're way below the Tabor limits. We're way below our own limits. By the way, Tabor and LD1, I think LD1 in some respects was even lower than Tabor. That was one of the ironies. But that's not what's controlling spending. It's we're running out of revenue. And I mean, the revenue is dropping off, and it's imposing a set of disciplines on the institution that we haven't seen since 2001, since 1991. It happens every 6 or 7 years.
Mm-hmm.
But we learn, actually, from these, and we need to learn from them, and we need to understand how to achieve sustainable reforms and cuts to the way in which we deliver services, both at the state level and, I'm afraid to say, at the local level as well. And then be able to hold those reforms and those efficiencies into times when the revenue starts flowing back again.
Thank you. So, Mr. Connors, given what we've heard so far and what your experience is and what you know about tax reform, can we do it?
Oh, can we do it?
And if so, when and how? In less than 2 minutes, please.
Oh. Can we do it? Absolutely we can do it. I think, again, not to pander, because that's not the purpose. I think, picking up on what Peter has said, it is absolutely true, and I wouldn't apologize for a second. If we don't get our arms around giving the public the confidence that we are dealing with our tax problem by controlling spending, he said it, we've all said it to one degree or another, that our current problem, as you've characterized, is revenues haven't kept up. And that is an issue that faces a legislature where they, as the governor has set the stage, you have to cut to balance that. Our effort to give people the confidence is to control the rate of spending at all levels, not just the state, and time doesn't allow, but it, you know, a lot has been accomplished. Ann has spoken of it, municipalities have been very compliant, education has not. Counties, with the exception of jails, have done a reasonable job, and the state has stayed under. LD1 gets panned, but in truth, it has done good work. Mm. Our concern is you need that extra threshold to make it harder to exceed that. Believe it or not, that gives a lot of people confidence, including ourselves, that you are controlling the rate of spending going forward. That foundation, and that was the same that was echoed by the coalition that Ann spoke of between education, municipalities, and the business community, then allows us to move into that second part, which is rebalancing the taxes. In the process, you lower the income tax and you expand it, that's a revenue neutral. What does it take? It takes that spending control that we speak of. It'll take a revenue neutral for the tax reform, and it takes an education understanding of, if you are one of those, bad choice of words, but victimized, that is a bad choice. I'll try another one. If you're one of those industries, businesses that are affected by an increase, it's important to all of us to understand to what degree is that mitigated if your income tax comes down. That's an education awareness, and we've got to try to get beyond the impact of the expansion and get to, as well. Now, it may end up those same opposite. But I also will say this, is that, and it probably is an expression of a Pollyanna, even at my age, change in this type of thing is not easy. It's not intended to be easy. The success in the first year that we've all applauded John and the committee for laid a great foundation. This year we're advancing the ball a little further. My problem in terms of giving a lot of confidence, and I am the internal optimist, is that the budget situation is going to consume so much time and energy that, I don't like to say it publicly because it's discouraging, that it may in fact be the reason we don't. But we shouldn't let that be the reason we don't if we can avoid it, because reform or burden, and burden I should say, does not get better if we put it off.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to next ask Martha. Martha, same question. Can we achieve tax reform? And if so, how and when?
I'm looking forward to achieving it in my lifetime.
My lifetime in the Baldacci administration is only going to be a couple more years, and I'm really hoping that it can happen then. I really, it's a fascinating subject. I think it's very important. I think it could help us accomplish a lot of other goals, too. But it's also a complicated subject, and it is hard for people, both in the legislature and in government and out in the public, to wrap their heads around it when they're feeling stressed and pressed in many other ways, especially out in the public these days, I think. So I do think, I know the governor feels that these efforts about government efficiencies and at all levels of government, and also right now to balance our state budget without a tax increase, are very important to helping us get to the place where we can do tax reform. 48% of our state budget is spent on education right now. 32% is spent on the Department of Health and Human Services. 2% on the 5 natural resource agencies. 8% on law enforcement and public safety, and 8% on everything else, which is the governor's office, the legislature, the judiciary, housing, planning, energy, economic development, tax collection, building maintenance, info technology, and more. And so we are obviously facing, they had the DHHS hearings on budget cuts, thousands of people, with every one of them having a really heartrending story about not wanting to touch anything that has to do with Medicaid or other human services. I would love to have a state where we can afford to help everybody with every need they have. We'll probably never achieve that. But all of us who can do, I don't think we can, in the end, do all of that, and we have to make priority choices there and in K-12 education and in higher education. So that the tax dollars that we are spending really are getting us the quality services that we need and want. We don't have any room now to spend them on anything that has to do with anybody's ego, turf, silo. We really don't have it. It's not fair. And I hope we can do all of this. All of these things need to sort of happen on the same track, but I think I agree with Dana and Peter and Carl about hanging on to school consolidation. Unless we can prove to people that we can give them quality services in the most efficient way and set some priorities, that we can't be everything to everybody, even in the really hard parts of the budget, but if 80% of your budget is taken up in education and health and human services, we can't get a handle on decreased revenues without going at that.
Thank you, Martha.
So I hope we can run on all those tracks together. But we can't just do tax reform. We can't just do efficiency. We can't just do budget cutting. We've really got to keep it all moving ahead together.
Thank you, Martha.
Welcome.
Senator Turner, in your opinion, are we going to be able to achieve tax reform in Martha's lifetime?
Well, in Martha's lifetime, not sure about my lifetime. I've got one more bite at the apple. I'm term limited, so my active legislative career this time around will end realistically this spring. I think we all know that democracy is a very inefficient way to solve problems. And everybody gets to say, I'm always amused when people say, run government like a business. It isn't a business, it's government. The ability for us strategically to shift our tax burden away from earned income is very important. Because as LAFA has repeatedly proven, from state to state and country to country, when you lower those tax burdens on income, you generate more income. Mm-hmm. And so anything that we do that lowers the taxes on earned income interest income, dividends, and capital gains will only help Maine in the long term. It was the overriding reason that I supported John Piotti's tax package last spring. It's the reason I very much want to support it again this spring. And we don't solve the problem in a day or a week, but we got to put the structural pieces in place that over time will help generate more income rather than less. We got too many places for people to march, and a lot of them march with their feet. And I would just quote a former associate of mine who said, Maine is a great place to start a business. And we've done some wonderful things over the years to help promote business formation. The problem is when those businesses get successful, they end up expanding elsewhere because we're not a great place to grow a business. And we need to change that. And I think this package that's before us is yet another opportunity to work that over positively.
Thank you, Senator Turner. Ann, is MMA willing to support tax reform in the current session? And do you see realistically tax reform being supported by the coalition that you had described earlier?
Well, I guess I'd like to respond by saying I want to share something a citizen sent me, which I really thought was sort of interesting. It says, can you do comprehensive tax reform? It said, well, you can't do it in good times because there's no need for it. You can't do it in bad times because there's no money for it. You can't do it comprehensively because it affects too many people. You can't do it incrementally because it unfairly only affects a few people. You can't do it in a first regular session of the legislature because everybody's too busy. And you can't do it in the second session because it's an election year. So you can't do comprehensive tax reform. Well, I think those are all good excuses, but I think you can. Do I think it's going to happen this session? I'm hopeful. I think MMA is certainly interested in all the same issues that we were interested in last year. I think that we need a focus first on spending and tax burden reduction, and then we need to move to more comprehensive tax reform. We also need to focus on investment. Those things will go hand in hand in the long term, but on the municipal side, we want to make sure we are talking reform, not just tax shifting. And maybe I sound gun-shy, but I'm just, in my 8 years on the town council, I've experienced a lot of stuff rolling down onto my head and onto the backs of the citizens of my town from Augusta, both in mandates and from, you know, reductions in revenues. So I think it will take political will to make it happen. And if everybody in Augusta's got the political will, they'll make it happen. It will take fiscal discipline at all levels of government. But, you know, I think if we can do that, that stability will be key for businesses and for the people of Maine. And we can do great things through your work in Augusta. So I wish you well.
Well, and are you sure that email was from a constituent, not John Martin?
No, it's not from John Martin, no.
Senator Mills, then Representative Piotti, and then we'll entertain some questions from our audience.
I personally would be very supportive. I think it will fail this year. It's the same people voting on somewhat similar issues in a climate that's not improved. But, you know, that's why we have new legislatures. New legislators elected every 2 years. There'll be a third of new people, new faces next fall, and we can start again. We will be using those documents and those provisions as the starting point, and we'll work from there.
Thank you. Okay, John, you've heard the issues, the barriers, the concerns. How are we going to do it?
Well, I've been in a fascinating spot for the last 15 months, and that gentleman out there in the audience, the
yes.
Speaker of the House, the man who put me there, my background was not in tax.
It is now.
It is now. I've learned an awful lot. It's been fascinating. My training is in engineering and public policy, not politics, public policy. I'm a problem solver, and the approach I've taken to this over the last 15 months is there's got to be a way to crack it. And although part of that answer is maybe the right balance of things, the right provisions, a lot of things that I've heard today are pieces that we've gone back and tweaked and mm-hmm. changed, and even on the spending restraint side, I think we have answers to that. But I think all of that, in some ways, is less important than cracking the other nut. And what I've learned in the last 15 months is that this really isn't about policy as much as it's about trust. We have folks who, in essence, don't trust each other. I've been in the middle for the last 15 months trying to figure out a way of making it work. And you can come up with good policy on both sides, but ultimately it comes down to the fact that some of the more progressive elements in the legislature, boy, they really don't want any long-term, permanent restraints on what they're going to do for understandable reasons. And the business community basically doesn't trust the legislature to say, we're going to do something, we're going to put it in place, we're not going to utilize future revenues if we're lucky enough and this works and we have some growth from it. We're not going to use future revenues to just be a bunch of drunken sailors. And for me, I think that's ultimately what it comes down to. And I don't think you can tweak the policy one way or another. You can add this provision or that. Nothing's ever going to solve it. The only thing that's going to solve it is the same solution to any issue of trust. The players have to get together, reach out, make themselves vulnerable, and do it. So I'm not sure it's ever going to work as long as we just play at the policy edges. I think we need fundamentally to approach the subject differently. Having said all of that, I want to go back to something. I have two articles here, two op-eds, one that Peter and I wrote together last July and one that Carl Turner wrote last July. When they're probably a little outdated. It was just after all the fun. But the theme in Peter's and mine was this idea of diet and exercise in some ways. And I think that's part of the problem we have here. You heard it around this table. People aren't comfortable giving up one piece without the other. And yet, if you're overweight, if you're out of shape, you need to do both. You can't cut yourself to prosperity. You can't just cut down to a 1,200 calorie a day diet and expect to be in good shape. But we are fearful of taking one step without taking the other. We're fearful of reforming our tax system, what I call the exercise portion, because we don't think the person is willing to put up with a 2,000 calorie diet. And the truth is, we need them both. I said I'm an engineer by training. The most difficult thing is to get people to think about problems that involve two variables. We're incapable of it. We can only focus on one thing at a time. And that's the underlying problem that we have here. We have a two-variable problem, and our systems aren't designed to deal with it. I think the only solution is to keep talking and get over that hurdle of lack of trust.
Well, thank you, John. I want to now take a moment. Before we move to the questions, I just want to recognize an important person in our audience, Speaker of the House, Glenn Cummings. Glenn is a Democratic representative from Portland serving his fourth term. Under Speaker Cummings' leadership, the legislature has passed the largest economic investment bond package in Maine's history, one of the nation's most aggressive and comprehensive anti-predatory lending laws, and numerous initiatives to improve higher education opportunities and the environment. Speaker Cummings holds the distinction of being the first clean election candidate in the country. He is a professor of economics at Southern Maine Community College, where he founded and served as director of the Entrepreneurial Center, dedicated to fostering and supporting student entrepreneurial growth. And I thank you very much for coming, Speaker Cummings. And following some questions from the audience, I'm going to ask the speaker to provide some closing remarks. At this time, if there's anyone in the audience who would like to make a question, I'd ask that you please go up to the podium so that the television camera can focus in on you and our audience members can hear the question. If you could please identify yourself, and then I've asked people to attempt to limit their question to about a minute, just so that everybody has an opportunity to ask a question and that our panelists have enough time to provide a response.
Okay,
good evening.
Okay, my name is Albert DeMillo. I live in South Portland. I am a CPA with 30 years of tax experience. I recently retired, came back to Maine, worked out of state in Massachusetts for the last 12 years. I did a lot of work because I was retired to look at the bill, and unfortunately, you are not a tax person, because if you knew the details, and taxes, the devil is in the details. So let me put it in the form of a question. Maybe you do understand the bill. The bill, I did the detailed analysis of the bill. The top 1.5% taxpayers, those in Maine making over $200,000 a year, under the proposal, we're going to save over $75 million in taxes. That's more than half of the $140 million. In addition, most middle-income individuals who own homes and itemized deductions would see a tax increase, a tax increase. My question is, if I can prove that, and I can, would you still be in favor of this law?
I believe your question. Thank you for that question. It's an excellent question. I believe the question is directed at Representative Piatti, who I'm going to ask to respond, and then if anyone other than the panelists want to respond as well.
First off, there were many different versions of the bill. It was tweaked and changed considerably. The overall progressivity is matched to the system that we have now. For people who were high deductors on the federal income tax system, there would be some who would have a greater burden under the system. It's the winner and loser thing. But generally, the progressivity is the same. We model this stuff not based on some broad economic assumptions. Maine Revenue Services has a very sophisticated model that actually has your tax return, my tax return in the system. So we know exactly how many people are affected in which way. And we looked at that. We looked at about 60 different versions of this.
And just in case, you answer the question, look, if I can prove to you that while that was linked to the Senate and didn't pass, the final version, which I did the detail on that, proved that $75 million was gone to the top 10,500 taxpayers. And that a substantial number of middle-income homeowners would see a tax increase. Would you still support the bill?
No. And I'd answer that question. Let's cut to the chase on this thing. About 14 years ago, when I first entered the legislature, I was sick and tired of hearing speculations about what would happen if we adjusted some tax or revenue item one way or the other. I put a bill in that said we need a resident expert within the Bureau of Taxation who has access to every single person and every single company's tax return, and we need firm and deliberate answers to these very difficult profiling questions of the very sort that you've just articulated. We hired a guy named Allen. I was the sole sponsor of the bill that created his job. Mike Allen is an economist. You need to have a conversation with Mike Allen, because there's nobody here. I don't have your expertise, but Mike Allen does. And he has access to data that I don't think you have access to.
Excuse me, sir. Only because we can't, because we're on air and you're not in front of a microphone. I'm going to ask at this point if you could just let the panelists respond, and then maybe after the.
I'd like to provide information.
I would love to see it, and I'll share it with Mike.
John and I would like to see the information. It's good. We're going to turn it over to Mike. All right, and he and his staff and his computers, and he has got access to data that I don't think is publicly available. The reason we put such a person in-house at the Bureau of Taxation is because I don't know what SAPI, for example, pays for taxes in the state of Maine, and you don't, because it's private information. I'm talking about every taxpayer. My tax return is not available to you. Your tax return and mine are both available to him. He's got all of this stuff in camera, as it were, and he models it, and his sole job, and he does a very fine job, at least as far as we're concerned, is to produce this very kind of demographic profiling that is essential to sound tax policy. So I appreciate that you've got a different perspective on the modeling of that bill, but you're arguing with the wrong people. We need to put you in touch with Mike Allen and resolve those differences.
I'll
I am willing to, following tonight's program, I'll take your name and number, and I'll be sure that I give you the Mike Allen's contact information.
And just so everybody knows, the version, the final version of the 60 that John looked at in his committee, that came out of his committee, the tax reform package, was named Mike. because Mike Allen ran every one of those 60 versions. And
I think that was Alpha, Baker, Charlie, Dog, Easy, Fox, well, down through
right.
Mike. Yeah,
right.
It was so far.
Started with letters, then we went to numbers, and then we went to the that system.
Well, thank you very much for raising that important question. Is there anyone else who has a question? If you could please identify yourself.
Thank you. I'm Jerry Milroy, a resident here in Cape Elizabeth. And first, I'd like to begin by thanking Cynthia, Representative Dill, for organizing this terrific forum.
Welcome.
Thank the attendees for taking the time out of your busy schedule to come to Cape Elizabeth and share this with us. And finally, thanking Representative Piatti and the Tax Committee for their terrific work that they've been doing on this issue. I want to voice my question as a resident here in Cape Elizabeth, but also as a former town planner in the town of Wells, and as a with a professional planning background, and as and writing articles and things at Portland Press Herald and communicating with the legislature, I guess since about 2004 on this topic. It seems that it's unfortunate that one of the issues the tax reform is still not addressing is the fundamental question of unfairness in the allocation of municipal property expenses through the property tax system, and fundamentally the constitutionally required property revaluations, which are taxing citizen taxpayers on income which is not being earned, on unearned income. And they see this as being unfair. It is what citizens' number one outcry is about property taxes. That's what the focus is on. And the lack of the responsiveness, albeit well-intended, to the circuit breaker programs and the homestead programs to respond to that unfairness. And their frustration. Last year, the governor's number two priority after school consolidation was to restrict property revaluations. And he initiated LD 276. There were a number of comments from the business community, real estate community, and so forth. My question, I guess, to and also Maine Municipal Association, if you go to their website and you click on property taxes, they recognize that property tax is the most regressive type of tax that you can have because you're being taxed on unearned income. The question, I guess, to the tax committee is it possible, or is the tax committee open to reconsidering addressing this unfairness and hopefully responding to some text which Representative Bliss has agreed to and wanted to introduce under this legislative session as a part of your work, and can that be considered, I guess, during this year?
Thank you, Jerry. John, if you want to respond, and then if anyone else has some feedback in response that might be responsive to that issue, I'd appreciate it.
I just want to first say, Jerry, you've been such an articulate and passionate spokesperson on this topic, and people in Maine should appreciate that because it is a critical issue. Having said that, for better or worse, the Tax Committee last year made a decision that property tax relief wasn't going to be the primary thrust of the track we were going down for a host of reasons. Maybe the biggest one is that it's been tried, it didn't work quite the level people wanted, and the feeling was we needed to go down a different track and try something different. Having said that, there were still some bills that dealt with the issue. We attempted to deal with some, not with others. To specifically respond to your question, there is nothing that is possible in my mind, not for lack of will, but just because of the realities of where we are. It wouldn't go anywhere in the next 3 weeks, 4 weeks that we have left. I think this is a critical issue. I think it needs to be addressed. I think it needs to be addressed fresh at the beginning of a new session. and I'll be very happy to work with Senator Bliss and others next year to introduce that bill.
Anyone else want to comment on?
I guess I would just make a pitch for what we can do this legislative session in terms of property tax. It's back to something Senator Turner said, which is hold on to the school consolidation law that was passed last year. As has been alluded to, when MMA and others sponsored the referendum to increase the state share of education funding to 55% and lower the municipal share to 45%, that has meant that the state has taken $800 million in income and sales tax dollars and turned it back to school funding with the hope, and LD1 was in place to try to encourage, more than just hope, that $800 million would translate into property tax relief. And as Ann knows better than anybody, property tax, the largest call on the property tax is from education funding, K through 12. So if we could hold on to the school consolidation law, find more efficiencies that way, and continue to maybe have to do more than encourage that $800 million additional school funding from the state to turn into property tax relief, that may take some of the pressures off. I understand that, you know, the valuation issue that you are so passionate about and are educating us all about is another part of that puzzle. But we do have something in place that could help property taxes a bit more, I think.
Thank you, Martha. Yes, Senator Turner.
Well, I've had an epiphany with respect to expecting property tax relief to come from Augusta. I've concluded it's pretty much of a fool's chase, especially when you consider that half of our general fund budget is turned back to municipalities now. And I'm fond of going to my hometown of Cumberland and standing at the dais and asking people to draw a 3-mile radius circle from that dais, and they will incorporate 6 municipalities with 6 town managers, 6 police departments, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I don't think you can send money downhill unconstrained and expect to get relief, because as the $800 million that Martha refers to largely has been spent. And yet, for those of you who signed the referendum petition, you were promised by the writers of that referendum question 85 cents of every dollar sent back home as a result of its activity would show up in property tax relief. And Martha Freeman, who runs the state planning office, as you well know, has done the analysis. And there are a few communities who did honor that commitment. Frankly, most did not. Some of them, in fact, spent every penny. So I think if you're looking for property tax relief, you've got to look in the mirror and look locally. That's the only way you're ever going to get it. And to make one last plug on school administration consolidation, one of the elements of that was a required budget validation vote that in its current posture is likely to be deferred for a year at a time when we desperately need it, in my opinion. And that deferral is being considered by your legislature, and in my judgment, a big mistake.
Thank you, Senator Turner.
Could I ask a question?
Yes.
Jerry, as this is a reflection or an adjustment to the bill that you worked on last year, or as a reflection of the governor's bill last year that intended to freeze property values. Is that correct?
Yes.
And as you well know, we opposed that because of the shift that it would represent to small business or to others that weren't directly affected by the freeze. I presume that with this, and I'll certainly take a look at it, and we'll talk, knowing you as I do, I'd be more than happy to discuss it further. I presume what you've done is try to address that tax shift in a way that would no longer be the case. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Okay, anyone else? Yes. Hello, Frank.
Yes, my name is Frank Miles. I live in Cape Elizabeth. I have a question that we focused a lot on the tax reform, but Mr. Connors talked about the tax, the spending threshold, and there's been widespread comment on the panel that, well, the hard times of the current budget has in fact put us on, to use John, to follow up John's duality, we've got the diet, I think, this year imposed by the lack of revenue. But I'm curious to know, in a more proactive way, what a threshold would look like. And I'd like you to comment and everybody else who has something to say about it, because there's been a lot of play in the press on tax reform. There's been a call for those thresholds, but I never know quite what the threshold is.
Okay.
Is there, are you going to hire another Mike with a hammer who's going to hit anybody on the head who proposes spending beyond a certain limit? Is there, what's it going to be?
That may be the next stage, but currently...
The duality.
Currently, LD1 that was passed came out of a plan the state chamber had put forward called the Maine Plan, and... They're all based, with the exception of education. Education has changed a bit, and let me start with that, because it came out of the recent school consolidation, and the limit there is contained in the EPS and so forth. But for the rest, the municipal and the county and education, for the municipal and county, it's real personal income measured over 10 years. Plus new development. That new development concept is one that allows municipalities to reflect to the new businesses that come to town so that they can respond to service or whatever growth there may be. For the state, they took real personal income but added population as opposed to new development. Those thresholds, those spending limits, let's put it that way, that threshold or spending limits has resulted, as Martha could tell you, because the planning office has followed this in the last few years, has reflected in a case where municipalities have stayed within that spending limit. And the counties have done okay. The jails are the ones that have put them over that percentage. And the percentage varied, but you could probably cite those for the various levels, Martha, that apply to state. And the state has done fine. The state did exempt the ramp up in school funding because it was an extraordinary amount of dollars that were being brought in. Once they reach a threshold, it becomes part of the spending limit from that point on. Very fair. Now, that's to say that they may not be perfect. As a matter of fact, one of the taxation committee members and working with taxation has said maybe there's a little bit of adjustments that need to be made because of what we've learned and experienced, a little inequity here or there. But overall, that's a matter of improving it, not destroying it. We've always argued, and Tabor 1 and Tabor 2 offers the same, that in addition to those spending limits, you need either, if you're going to exceed that spending limit, you need either a two-thirds vote or a referendum vote by the public. What we said with the coalition of Maine Municipal and the Education Association, that it would be a referendum vote in all of those levels of government unless you could get a two-thirds vote of the governing body. In those instances, that would suffice not having to go to referendum. The one exception, well, two exceptions. Education superseded that by their most recent legislation in which they said they all go to referendum. And in the case of counties, they all went to referendum because in many instances, you only have five county commissioners, so it became a matter of math. So what's lacking in law today that John and others are trying to address is that extra threshold that does not exist except in education, which is a referendum. And that is, we think you either to exceed that should get a two-thirds vote or a referendum to exceed the spending limit. And the spending limit is in law.
Thank you, Dana, very much. Yes, Anne, did you want to make a comment?
Yes, just to build on what Dana said, Frank, the coalition plan that we had worked on with the chamber and a number of other bodies last year really tried to institute stricter spending controls, which is, I gather, what you're interested in. It really needed to put more teeth into those spending controls rather than just having them be
targets, and then having nothing really happen if you missed the target. So the override procedures that Dana was talking about, the way it would work in Cape Elizabeth is on the in the municipal level, if we on the council were going to exceed, wanted to have the budget exceed the LD1 limit, then what we'd have to do is have, the budget would have to pass by 50%. Well, it would have to pass by 2/3%, which would be 5 votes of the 7. Or if it only just passed by majority vote, then it would have to go to the people. So it would have to go out to the citizens, and we'd have to have a referendum vote. And that would apply to all levels of government. At least that's the way it worked in the coalition plan, except the state couldn't be bound by that. And there were some issues about that last year, about rules changes, trying to have each legislature bind itself. But at least the counties and the schools and the municipalities would try to have those stricter teeth so that the, if the people, the citizens, wanted something in the budget to exceed those, they could vote for it and get it, but unless they really wanted it by voting for it, that limit would not be exceeded. So that's how it works.
John, I think it might be important just for you to comment at this point. I mean, is what you're hearing about what the business community and what MMA wants as far as a spending restriction or cap, is that something that's doable in your plan and in your big picture tax reform package that you are advocating?
Well, part of what we've been reaching out to the business community with is a package that balances the tax reform elements with certain spending constraints. And Dana alluded to it, many of the pieces, some of the pieces of 804, LD 804 from last year, some of the pieces from another LD 1582 that Representative Woodbury put forward, and some new concepts we've been floating and testing. So I'm always the optimist. I still think that there might be some package that could ultimately work there. I come back to what I said before, though, is, and in fact, I'll be at Dana's board meeting tomorrow, and we might have a more definitive answer as to whether or not some of those controls are enough or not. But the bottom line is, short of a constitutional amendment, which I don't think hardly anyone, is anyone in the middle of the road is advocating for now, there's nothing that you can do to completely bind the next legislature. And so it still comes down to some element of trust.
Cynthia, could I just,
yes,
real quick, just for Steve and everybody else, this is the LD1 report executive summary, and it's on the State Planning Office website, www.maine.gov/SPO. This is the, sound like Hillary Clinton pitching for funding or something. So this is the 4-page summary about the spending limits and whether they were met this last year by the state, the towns, the counties, and the schools. If anybody's interested, there's also on that website the 40-page number-crunching report done by a PhD economist, not John. That's all the background information. So to look there. And then just quickly on the spending limit thing, we have a real-world test going on in Augusta right this second. There's no way the state can meet its spending limit this year. We don't have the revenues to get up to our spending limit. And so, you know, it is wonderful in flush times. I think it is very important that we have these spending limits on everybody and find ways to make them more enforceable. But right now, we are forced to make some choices. Are we going to do something in the realm of the supplemental budget and the change package that the governor just put forward to actually lower state spending so that we will be spending this year at the state level less than we spent last year? That will be the first time in 35 years that the state government has from year to year gone backwards in its spending. If we make choices somewhere in some part of the neighborhood of what the governor has put on the table, they're very hard. There are winners and losers, and thank God I don't have to vote. Most of these people do, and God bless them for wanting that job, especially in these days. But we've got a real-world choice about whether we want to reduce spending in Maine right now. Another opportunity we're going to have is that the governor put forward a consolidation of the county jails and the state correction system. That's moving forward. I think we have a choice to make that happen, too. So we'll see. But we've got some concrete things we can do right now.
Thank you, Martha. I want to make sure we have time for questions from the audience. Please come forward.
I'll make it quick. I'm Beth Milroy. I'm a resident here in Cape Elizabeth. I'm also a teacher, and so I have a particular passion for hearing 48% of the budget towards education as well as 32% that goes to Health and Human Services. I think everyone here, and thank you for coming, I'm really impressed. there was a comment each of you pretty much said that revenues have not kept up, hence deficits, and we need to begin to control spending. My concern in hearing this, as I tend to think big picture, and I tend to be very optimistic, is we can continue to cut spending, but is anyone actually looking down the line as to what that means? At some point, we need to think, as a, I use the term at school, mind shifts. We need to think outside the box about education. We need to think beyond just what has been. You hear nationwide people say public school is broken. We need to fix it. Well, is that going to come with cutting costs, both for education and DHS, or can it be changed through some more creative mind shifts in eliminating senior year, in looking at preschool as a part of school programs to deliver across the board supports, not just for children, young children, but also young families who could get the support from educators and whatnot. Anyway, so I'm sure there are people in Augusta who are thinking along those lines, and I want to really commend Baldacci for consolidations. I think it's the first, but unfortunately I don't think he went as far as he could have gone. Anyway.
Thank you very much. Senator Thanks. Mills, I'm going to ask you to respond to that question only because you are the ranking member of the Education Committee.
I think that we're not asking the right questions in regard to most governmental services. For example, we have no systemic way of tracking how many seven-year-olds can't read. We don't even know. We don't really have, on the top of my head, I can't tell you what our recidivism rate is with regard to prisons and jails. The economists like to tell us that if you buy, you know, if you are purchasing services from a service provider, a bureaucrat, or a teacher, or someone, and you don't know what you're buying, if you're just buying seat time for children, or if you're buying prison time for criminals, beds, if we're just counting beds, and if people's jobs are made more important by the numbers of beds and the numbers and the sheer quantities that they're processing, and you're not asking for, well, wait a minute, what's the end result? What's being achieved here? And there are so, in education, there are so many remarkable methods of assessment now that are available off the shelf from, and they're remarkably inexpensive. And some of them are taking root in Maine, and I think that we need to look at new graduation requirements, as you've suggested, and begin to ask, well, what are we're asking for an educated child. Aren't there ways of understanding when we've achieved that, that aren't based on models that were developed 50 and 100 years ago? So I think that governments all over, Maine in particular, would benefit greatly from changing the way in which we ask questions of those who are providing services. In the Health and Human Services arena, how many people are weaned from those services and made independent? Shouldn't we be calling the Department of Human Services the Department of Human Independence? Isn't that the work product that we're asking of them at root? I just think Governing Magazine has this as its theme, pretty much. It's a national magazine that most of us read, and I'm just fascinated by the opportunities that would result from just asking the right questions from day to day and getting away from, getting into performance-based systems and getting away from looking at the sheer quantities of things that are being processed by governments in various modes.
Thank you, Senator Mills, and thank you, Ms. Brown. Is there anyone else in the public who has a question? Yes, please, sir, come forward. I think we have time for one more. And is there anyone else, just so I can gauge? Okay.
My name is Bill Gross. I'm a resident of Cape Elizabeth. And I wanted to ask a more philosophical question about tax reform versus tax relief. We had a committee on Tabor, a town committee, to discuss the pros and cons of Tabor here, and I was on that committee. And there were two very different camps. There was one camp who were worried if we cut or restricted the increase in spending, we probably would end up cutting programs that were valuable. And that seems like a very natural fear for those people in that camp. Then there were people in the other camp, the camp that I was a member of, that thought, well, the very fact, when we look at the relative tax burden of the local taxes on the citizens in the state of Maine, was either number one or number two. That's the relative. When you take all of the state and local taxes, add them all together, we were somewhere in the middle, just in a raw number. But when you divide it by the average income of a citizen of the state of Maine, we were either the most heavily taxed or the next most heavily taxed. In our group, we thought this was proof positive that the local taxes, state and local taxes, were oppressive. It wasn't as if this is an arguable fact. If we're the highest taxed or the next highest taxed, then that's an oppressive tax. Now, the reason I'm asking the question is it seems to me from the work on Tabor, and that was the two variables we had. We had one camp very much opposed to the other, and we went through all kinds of very heated arguments back and forth across this. But from my point of view, from the Tabor point of view, it seems like the program you're talking about, you gave a very clear explanation of the program and why it's really just shifting the burden from one to another, but the total tax will still stay the same. And that means the relative tax burden for the state of Maine, we're still going to stay up there at number one or number two. It seems to me that Tabor, in some form or another, is going to keep coming back and again and again and again, as long as you move the burden around, but the total tax burden makes us number one or number two.
Thank you.
Now, I graduated from, well, I went to Chevis High School back in the 50s and 60s, and in American history, I got assigned, every one of us got assigned a project of a Supreme Court case. So the one I got stuck with was McCulloch versus Maryland. And I don't remember much about it, but it was some teller in the Bank of the United States getting arrested for not paying taxes to the state of Maryland. But I remember a phrase that from the research, and I still remember today, and from John Marshall's decision, and he said, "The power to tax is the power to destroy." Now, this is just...
I'd like to get Mr. Piotti's response to your question,
sure.
Only because we have one more question, and we have the speaker, and we have 4 minutes.
Then I'll
so, Mr. Gross,
up by
I think I understand
thing.
Your question.
If
yes?
Taxes are, by definition, oppressive because we're number one and two. If taxes are this powerful force that pushes down on us and has the capability of destroying us, isn't it a nobler objective, a nobler goal? If your committee says, we're not just going to look at tax reform, we actually will look at this and create a package that reduces taxes so that we no longer are number one or number two. If you do that, I think the pressure for the Tabor proponents will go away. Once we move
okay,
down from number one
question.
Or number two, Tabor will no longer come back to haunt you.
Okay.
It's a great question. It gets to the heart of the issue. It gets to the heart of some of the misunderstandings with the issue as well. There really are two things going on here. First off, if you just look at our overall tax system, there are reasons to modify it, to reform it in a way that would have a different shift in order to help us solve the problem that you identified. If we can help grow our economy, if we can do that, that's one vehicle to help solve the problem. Our incomes go up, our tax burden goes down. A Tabor-like solution assumes that there's money to cut. You just heard that we're under that level anyway. I'm not going to go down the path of whether or not if we had more money we should be cutting or this or that. That's irrelevant. Let's just look at the times that we're in. We don't have that option. We do have an option to take the system that's before us, which is a tax code that doesn't serve our purposes, and make it better. I come back to what I said before. I think we need both. I think we need responsible spending, but right now, it's hard to imagine how you get any leaner than we are. And you also need a tax policy that's going to encourage growth. And what we're doing is preventing ourselves from taking the second because the times don't allow us to have the first.
I'll only...
And Dana, you wanted to...
One very quick footnote to your point is that we do need both, as John mentioned. But I will say to collaborate your point is that the LD spending limits, if all levels, not just the state is for the reasons you've heard, but the state, county, education, municipalities, if we all lived within those spending limits going forward, in 10 years, you'd be in the middle third of a tax burden in this country if you stayed within it. That's what prompted it. That was the basis behind LD1 and the motivation for doing it. So to your point, if you can set up, which we have the spending limits, and you do not exceed them, that will be accomplished, and the issue will go away, as you say.
Thank you. And I've got to just add one. Okay.
I think Dana's directionally correct, but it presupposes that 49 of the other 50 states stay static.
That's true.
That's good. Yes, we are dynamic.
I admitted that small point.
I do think, coming back to a point I beat on earlier, that when you reduce rates on earned income, whether it's interest, dividends, capital gains, or just the sweat of your off your brow, that's a further incentive for greater income. And this is a fraction. It's your tax burden divided by your available income. You drive up the income and the burden stays the same. Of course, on it goes down if you keep everything else flat.
Thank you, Senator Turner. Yes, sir.
I'm Tom Dunham. I live in Cape Elizabeth. And I'm really very concerned because I look at the direction of the state of Maine. And I just turned 60. I look at Dana and Peter and Carl. No, we're all baby boomers, and we're finishing our business careers. And when you talk to, at least when I talk to my friends, many of us, and I'm not saying I'm in that camp yet, are looking at the income tax burden to us today and in retirement, and they're going to exit the state.
Absolutely.
If we exit the state, this thing is really going to spiral down.
Exactly. So, the superdelegates leaving, yes.
Yeah. So I would like to ask Mike, Peter through Mike, I guess, right? You talk to Mike. There must be a level of income tax rate for people over 60 that they would say, well, I'll pay it instead of leaving. So you only have to leave 181 days. They can still have their home, nice home in Cape Elizabeth or on the coast. They're out of here. If they're out of here, they're not supporting the nonprofits, places greatest requirements on the nonprofits and the hospitals, because that income's gone. And their interest in the state of Maine is gone.
They're not buying legal and accounting services either.
That's absolutely right.
Senator Mills, would you like to?
I hate to advertise these issues, frankly, but it's not just the income tax, it's the estate tax nonconformity, it's the excise tax on the automobiles, it's property taxes, which are fairly high in our state. So there are a host of reasons why Florida looks more and more appealing, as ugly and as flat as it is.
No, but for many people, middle-income people, it's, you know, they look at what they're paying and say, hey, I'm out of here for 181 days.
I've talked to many people about this over the years, and frankly, it's a sliding scale phenomenon, and we are very high on the scale of adversity.
Yeah, absolutely.
And one last thing, if you'd like to raise revenue quickly, because my family's in this process right now. It takes a year to go through probate and settle that up. If you want to, I don't know how many people are in the revenue service, but my mother passed away in July. We will not settle that up for about 12 months. If you put it out to the CPAs in town, and, you know, if you can't handle it internally at the state, turn it around in 6 months. I mean, there's a lot of money there, I would think, that could help you out right now.
Thank you very much, Mr. Dunham, for those comments. Before, may I now invite the Speaker of the House, Mr. Glenn Cummings, to come up and to speak with us. In advance, I'd just like to thank sincerely, Mr. Speaker, for joining us and providing some closing remarks. Yes, please. And I just want to recognize very briefly in the audience, we have Representative Brian Kainrath from South Portland, who I welcome. Representative Kainrath is our youngest member in the main House of Representatives. I also see Representative Baudet. Welcome, Representative Baudet. We also have a member of the Town Council, Paul McKenney. Thank you very much for joining us. And Mr. Speaker, if you...
Thanks for having me here, Cynthia. And I just want to say, if that beam cracks and falls down on this particular panel, the IQ in the Maine legislature is going to drop by 50 points overnight. So you have a terrific bunch of people. And thank you, Cynthia, for your leadership in helping us. You too, Dennis.
Oh, I knew why I was a minute.
What are we, chopped liver?
Well, speaking of that, I was going to say, you know, in New Hampshire, they say if you're an aspiring politician, you work really hard to get into the New Hampshire House, and if you're lucky, you work hard to get into the New Hampshire Senate. And then if there's an opening and you're really, really lucky, you can run for selectman. And that really tells you that how much they value local control in New Hampshire. And I have to tell you, we are a step sideways from that. So when we talk about these big issues from state government, when we think about 300-400 years of committed people to my piece of rock in Maine, you think, why is tax reform so difficult? Why am I so proud of John Piatti and these two gentlemen stepping out on their party leadership to do the right thing here a little bit? For these guys, in 40 years, we have not had a major change in tax policy. It was passed in the House. And quite frankly, if the governor hadn't stepped out the last minute on this thing, and I want to go back to the issue of trust, we would have had the first major tax overhaul in the history of the state in about four decades, and it almost happened as a result, mostly of this man, but these two, their terrific leadership, especially given their party leadership squeezing them otherwise. I do want to say, in terms of the governor, and going back to the trust issue, I think the governor has done terrific things. I saw him come to Deering High School, where 400 people showed up, and he was determined to push school consolidation, and they hated it. And he must have taken 400 punches in the face that night, and he never flinched. And I have to give him credit for that. His desire for efficiency and the strength that he showed in doing that was terrific. Unfortunately, tax reform, he lost his step. And I can't tell you why, but I think it was a trust issue. I think John hit it right on the head. It's a trust issue. He didn't trust you to understand it was a good thing. He didn't trust you. He thought it was going to come back on him, and he thought it was going to come back on everybody else. He thought you couldn't understand that if you raise some levels of taxes on your base and drop that income tax, he couldn't quite trust. He got it, I think, intellectually himself, but I don't think that he trusted that you'd get it. And then I think it goes back to Peter's excellent comment. Why did the very conservative wing of his party really oppose this? They needed to see those spending reductions first, no question about it. But unfortunately, you can't get the other side to jump into the middle until you get both. And so our fear, and it's proven a little bit true, John Piatti and I have been going to the Chamber of Commerce, and we've been saying, you know, if we got to the spending caps, and we got them in place, and we got the Democrats behind those kind of spending caps, would you be okay with the spending package? And they've kind of come back and some pieces have said, well, get it in place first, and then we'll do it. And then we take that back and we say, but we want to see you give up something too. And so it's that balance, and that's why you're going to need the governor, I think, to step forward. Now, maybe you're waiting for another governor to step forward on this, and there are probably about five hopefuls in the room, so that ought to be helpful. But if you don't want to wait, you've got to get this man over here, Mr. Connors, and you've got to get the business community to tell the governor it's okay. And until the business community really steps forward and says, you know, this is a good thing, lowering that top marginal rate, wow, what a great thing for Maine businesses, small businesses, large businesses, et cetera. But until you get that business community, the business community did a forum, I love this one, the Greater Portland Forum on Taxes in October, and the title was, Tax Reform, Will It Fail Again? So with that kind of enthusiasm from the business community, that kind of leadership from the business community, you're probably not going to get it with this governor. But
if you can make that happen, and they can make it, say, look, if you can put these spending caps on, you can make this happen, and the business community is reasonably behind it. You've got great articulate spokesmen in the Republican Party to say this is a good thing. If we can get the business community to say it, I think the governor maybe this round or maybe even next round, next couple of years, could do it. So I'm very optimistic about it. I want to finish by saying what the bigger discussion here tonight is, because I don't think, for me, it's about taxes alone, and I think we've already heard that theme. If you want to have a great, prospering state, you got to do three things. The first is you got to have an educated group of people. You got to raise incomes by capacity and skill. And right now, our biggest competitor, our biggest competitor is Massachusetts. I ignore that land of big mountains and small men. And if our biggest competitor is Massachusetts, we are 14 percentage points behind Massachusetts in the number of people who hold college degrees of any kind, 14 points behind. If you want one explanation why we're not thriving economically, you have to go to that issue. It is scary. And we're 7 percentage points behind the rest of the New England average. That is something that has to change. And if we did that, our incomes would grow, our total tax burden would reduce. Secondly, you got to have something you're really good at that nobody else in the world is good at. We have that. We've got the most beautiful place in the world to live. And if we push that and we hold on to that, and if we lose that to malls, if we lose that to all kinds of parking lots and all kinds of subdivisions, if we lose that, I'm not sure we're going to win, because we're not going to have the lowest labor price points, and we're not going to have the best energy costs, we're not going to have the best health costs, but we do have one thing, and it's a great, phenomenal place to live. And then finally, you got to worry about those price points. One of them is taxes, one of them is energy, one of those is health care. So when we talk about taxes, we are grossly inefficient. I think you heard that, and this is what this discussion is, but I think we need to remind ourselves tonight that the larger discussion is, where is Maine's prosperity going to come from? Taxes are one piece of a list, of a comprehensive list, of which it's going to come from. So if we don't do those other things, we won't get that prosperity. I think it's about that prosperity. So with that, I just want to say thank you, Cynthia, for inviting us, and thank you for everybody who's put so much work into this effort.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, very much, and thank you, panelists. And we're a few minutes behind schedule, and I apologize, but I want to thank all the members of the audience very much for coming. For those of my friends on the air who are watching, thank you for watching. And I want to thank Heidi Overbeck for all her assistance, and good night. Wait, this is still on.